Well, good morning, Holy Cross here. It's good to see you here on this snowy morning. I'm glad you arrived safely. We know that you are here because you did that here. But a special welcome to those that are joining us from home. It's a perfect morning to do that as well, get nice and cozy and warm here. But we are glad to worship here with you this morning. So with that, I invite you to stand. Let us join in singing.
Our opening song, I Build Your Kingdom Here. Maybe we should change it to Build Your Snowy Kingdom Here. Oh, thank you. All right, I better get plugged in here to the system. There we go. Come set your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray. Unveil why we're made. Come set our hearts ablaze with hope, like wildfire in our very souls. Holy Spirit, come invade us now. We are your church. I was thinking about my students as I look out at the high school kids, and this whole pandemic experience can be very heavy on our hearts. Grown-ups, kids, things that seem little now might feel much heavier. And so as we look around and we support each other through Christ, just know that there are those who need prayers. Those who are struggling emotionally, that are experiencing loss or pain right now. And so please lift them up in prayer. Not for a moment are we ever, ever alone.
Even when I could not
let's join here in prayer. Almighty God, we confess that we have taken your commandments and turned them into rules. We've criticized those who have fallen short and selfishly proclaimed others as righteous. And we have failed to understand the spirit of the commandments and the way that has shown us, the way that was shown to live by you as our loving God and loving our neighbors. Forgive us for turning your law into burdens for others and ourselves instead of a way to love and freedom in you. And holy God, we come together this morning, this afternoon, tonight, whenever, to worship as a people who would like to think that we love you with all of our hearts and souls, with all our might. There are so many other things in our lives that clamor for our attention, and that we often relegate you to Sundays and Wednesdays and times when we want you to rescue us. But most of us really do want you to be the one in whom we live and move and have our being. We really do want to hear your voice above all and above all other voices in our lives. But we get bogged down in this daily routine and we forget who we are. We forget who you are. We forget what the church is supposed to be. So here we are, standing before you today with our human foibles and our short attention spans, asking that you would make yourself known to us and that you would help us to recognize the presence of you as holy, that you would continue to challenge us, inspire us, and make us into the people you want us to be. We thank you, God, for coming to us as a neighbor, a stranger, an immigrant, and binding our wounds and carrying us to safety so that we might love you with our whole heart, our soul, and our mind, and that we would welcome the stranger and love our neighbor as ourselves. Amen.
For our offering song this morning, we're going to sing our Lutheran anthem, "A Mighty Fortress," because in 1517, this movement that we know now as the Reformation started, and a man named Martin Luther would change the way we look at our faith and would challenge us in ways we never thought possible. So here we go, "Mighty Fortress."
Thank you.
Well, for our kids talk today, I decided to pull out something a little fun today. So our video here today is a good old throwback to the Playmobil sets that you might have played with as a kid, or I know they're kind of coming back around again, which I am super excited for. But today, as Pastor Mark alluded to, and as you're kind of picking up on the feel that we have around here, is it's Reformation Day. And I could explain what Reformation is, but nothing explains the Reformation like Playmobil does.
This is the story of Martin Luther. He got up to some pretty adventurous things. He was kidnapped by knights on horseback, lived in disguise in a castle, and helped some nuns escape from a convent by hiding them in barrels. But as a young man, he was troubled by a deep sense that he wasn't right with God. Once, in a thunderstorm, a lightning bolt nearly struck him. He thought he was going to die, and he cried out for help to one of the saints, saying rashly, "Save me, and I'll become a monk." He survived. And so, true to his word, he gave up his studies as a lawyer and became a monk. His friends and family said he was wasting his talent. In the monastery, he started reading the Bible. He discovered that it was God's mercy and love that was all that was needed to be right with God. And for the first time in his life, he found a deep peace with God. Luther was invited to be a lecturer at the University of Wittenberg. He taught through books of the Bible, and his lectures were popular. Even ordinary people from the town came along. In those days, the Catholic Church was telling Christians that their good behavior could earn them heaven. But Luther knew from the Bible that no amount of good works could earn you forgiveness. Not even the Pope was able to give forgiveness from God. Only God could do that. Luther saw that the Church had left behind what the Bible taught and was even making things up for its own gain. He decided he must teach against these false ideas. He made his complaints public by nailing them to the place in town where people published important documents, the door of the castle church. He explained that it wasn't possible to buy God's forgiveness or to live a life that was good enough to deserve to know God. His writings showed that God wants to forgive the wrong we've done, and that this is only possible because Jesus, the Son of God, came to pay the punishment that our wrong deserved. Jesus did this as he died in our place. Luther's ideas quickly spread throughout Europe, thanks to a recent invention, the printing press. The Pope wrote a document saying that Luther had to take it all back, and if he didn't, he'd be treated as a heretic. Luther refused and publicly burned a copy of the Pope's letter. Luther's ideas shook things up religiously, politically, and culturally. He was soon summoned to stand before the emperor and answer for his supposed crimes of explaining what the Bible said. The emperor declared Luther an outlaw, banning his literature. And that's when he was rescued and went to live in disguise in a castle. Dressing in knight's clothing, he changed his name to Sir George and grew his hair and a beard, and spent his time translating the New Testament. Again, it was published widely, meaning ordinary people could read the Bible for the first time. Luther then secretly returned to Wittenberg. He continued to write books and translate the Bible. He also got married and had a family. Europe was buzzing with Luther's message about the Bible. Today, 500 years on, the truths of the Bible that Luther knew continue to impact millions of people. People who've come to know God personally, knowing the peace and forgiveness Jesus offers us. The forgiveness that Luther found is still available today. We can all be in a right relationship with God because of one man, the Lord Jesus Christ.
Well, this morning, we, along with thousands of other churches throughout the world, are celebrating Reformation Sunday. It's a day where we remember the work of the Protestant reformers of the 1500s who realized that church had strayed from the gospel and had begun abusing its power to control the people. Give me one second here. I feel like I've got some feedback on my mic, so I'm going to turn it down. Come down there. There we go. That's better. So this Sunday is meant to coincide with October 31st, as we saw in the video there, the date that Luther nailed those 95 theses to the door of that old church in Wittenberg, Germany. And those 95 theses were 95 points of protest against the official teachings and practice of the church, highlighting where they'd strayed from the teachings of Jesus and outlining how they, according to Luther, could return to the fullness of the gospel. It's remembered and celebrated as a religious movement, but the Reformation was so much more than that. It may have started in the church, but it spilled over into the streets, into everyday life, into the politics, into the way that people were seeing each other. And some might say that that Reformation movement started and is still continuing today in many ways right here in America. You might say that since those days, a movement of Reformation was started and has never ceased, a tradition of questioning tradition, of examining the teachings and explanations of those in authority for oneself. This new way of Christian living develops. One of the key mottos that emerged out of the Reformation was the phrase reformed and reforming, meaning that the Christian church was always meant to be undergoing some spirit-led, scripturally based reformation, hearkening to the voice of God as we move forward in history. Today's celebration serves as a reminder to us to never grow content with the things the way that they are. Rather, we're called always to be heeding that voice of God, that wild voice that sends us into new adventures, calling us to go out and do new things. This morning we turn to John's Gospel, the 8th chapter, and we're reminded of this calling, beginning with the 31st verse. Jesus said to the Jews who had believed in him, "If you continue in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free." Well, they answered him, "We are descendants of Abraham and have never been slaves to anyone. What do you mean by saying that you will be free?" Well, Jesus answered them, "Very truly, I tell you, everyone who commits sin is a slave to sin. The slave does not have a permanent place in the household. The son has a place there forever. So if the son makes you free, you will be free indeed. I know that you're descendants of Abraham, yet you look for an opportunity to kill me because there's no place for you in my world. I declare what I have seen in the Father's presence. As for you, you should do what you have heard from the Father." Word of God, word of life. The Christian tradition at its core is one of reformation. And that reformation didn't begin with Luther and his 95 theses in Wittenberg. We see it right here in these gospel stories, that the Reformation begins with this renegade Jewish rabbi named Jesus coming to the scene and mucking up the civil and religious traditions of his day. He healed the sick on the Sabbath in direct violation of the Word of God. He touches the unclean and unworthy and extends forgiveness to violators of God's law. He overturns tables and speaks truth to the religious powers of his day. And all of this ultimately costs him his life. Jesus enters the world and he challenges the expectations and the practices of the world, turning society, turning everything that was known and valued at the time on its head. So when we say that we follow Christ, we're saying that we are followers of the greatest reformer that ever lived. And when we say we follow Jesus, we're committing ourselves to being a people that always hearken to the new things that the Spirit of God is saying to us. Jesus told us when he left that he would send the Spirit to lead us forward into all truth. And the implication then is that there's much truth left to be revealed. More tables to be overturned. More scriptures to be expanded. More traditions to be busted open. More people to be welcomed in. We as followers of Christ are people of reformation, always called to be listening for a fresh word from the Spirit, always being willing to break past our comfort zones and move into the wild, uncharted territories that God is calling us to. And yet, here, 2,000 years after Jesus, 500 years after the reformers of the early church, there's still much more reform needed. I believe that we have become stagnant in the church. We've refused to hear what the Spirit is saying and to expand our boundaries to become all that God desires us to be. We're a stubborn people, preferring comfort over action, preferring what's good over what's best for all. But God is calling us to move forward, calling us to change the way that we think, calling us to change the way that we believe. But more than that, God is calling us to change the way that we show up each and every day in the world. Friends, we've become way too complacent in the face of great injustices on our doorstep. Over the past year alone, God has revealed to us the deep-seated racism and sexism that is alive in the hearts of our nation. The corruption of different policies that take the lives of thousands of children of God and cast them aside. We've been shown the effects of our selfish ways that are destroying our planet, depleting its natural resources. In many cases, the church has responded to these. But our church hasn't. What are we doing to address these things? How are we being part of the reformation that's taking place in our world today? How are we working to end the systemic problem of oppression that begins, might I suggest, right here, largely in communities of faith, teaching us to segregate and even hate those who are different from us? How are we helping to save our planet? How are we giving of our own wealth and power to support those who have none? These are the Reformation questions that we must be asking today as that movement still lives on in our world. I'm afraid that we've forsaken the gospel of Christ, a gospel which is first and foremost good news to the poor and liberation for the oppressed and sight for the blind, jubilee for all. With this consumeristic, capitalistic, materialistic, self-serving gospel. One that says, what about me? What about what I want? What about what I need? What about what my rights are? Overlooking doing what is right and best for our neighbor. In America, the church has forsaken the kinetic way of Jesus that calls us to humble ourselves, to take the form of a servant, and to sacrifice all that we are for the good of our neighbors and our enemies. In the church, we've preached this false image of God to the masses. Both conservatives and progressives have molded and created a God that is different from the one that is revealed in Jesus. We've made a God who supports our ideas, our viewpoints and perspectives, and a God who values our people and sees us as the elect. A God who is so narrow and finite that he can only be present with those who feel the most right and righteous. But the God revealed in Jesus is a God who is altogether an outsider. A God who is unique and expansive, a God in whom every molecule of the universe is held together, and a God who is made manifest primarily not in scriptures or temples made by human hands, but in the faces of our neighbors and our enemies. We are followers of Christ, the great reformer. We here this morning find ourselves in the true Protestant tradition, one that values above all else the ability to critique and progress beyond staleness and corruption. We of all people are people of reformation. And this new reformation that I'm convinced that God is up to is one of the Spirit. It's a reformation that begins with each and every one of us. Stopping and centering ourselves each and every day, listening to that still small voice within us that's calling us to move forward into the fuller expression of God's kingdom. This morning, it's my hope that we would all heed that call to reform. It's so easy to listen and say amen or yes, exactly. It's so easy to have in mind another group of people that you think need to be reformed. But this word isn't for another group. It's for us. Reform begins right here, in our hearts, in our lives. Change begins here, and it's not the job of religious leaders or politicians or activists to bring it. The Spirit is working and is calling you, calling me. We are the agents of reform. We are called to wake up each and every day and look at our world and ask, where, God, is it that you're leading me today? What reform are you working through me? That is our task. May we always be reformed and always be reforming for the sake of the gospel, for the sake of each other, for the sake of our neighbor and our world. Amen. I invite you to pray here with me this morning. God, we lift up our hearts to you this morning with great praise and adoration, knowing that it's because of you that we sit here today. there, but for the grace of God I go is a phrase that we hear, but Lord, we know it's true in our lives. We know your love fills those deep voids, washes through, and brings light to those dark places that we have of guilt and shame. Lord, we know that you transform our lives. And we pray today, Lord, that that transformation that you're working in us would indeed work through us to bring about change and reform in the world around us as well, to bring hope and healing to our neighbors, to bring life and love to all corners of this world. Lord, bless us. Bless us with the ability to listen and hear your voice where it is that you're leading, and the wisdom and strength to follow, that all may come to know your Son as we do. Your Son who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Well, as we get ready to head out here this morning, a couple things I want to draw your attention to, and they're all coming up here this weekend. The first being is we're still collecting candy for our pumpkin event. So if you're out shopping and picking up your Halloween candy for this Saturday already, we ask that you donate here. And that is going towards our pumpkin decorating contest that is being held on Saturday afternoon. And this is for all ages. So you can decorate a pumpkin to whatever your heart desires, calls it out to be, and drop-off is starting this week already. So if you have it ready to go, you can drop it by here in the entryway and we'll get them displayed. And then voting is going on from 12 to 4 on Saturday. So you can stop anytime, cast your vote for your favorite pumpkin, and the first three places will win a gift card to Stensland Ice Cream. So it's going to be warm enough this weekend that you can enjoy it. It probably won't be so good today, but you will be able to enjoy it this next week here. But as you go on your way, I invite you to stand, and we'll send you out with a blessing and a song here. Well, as you go, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. And may the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Amen. As we seek ways to give back to our community through Holy Cross, we have our blood drive also, not tomorrow, but the next Monday, November 2nd. So if you're available to contribute in that way, that is just as awesome too.
Why should I lose heart? I know how great you are.
Go in peace. Serve the Lord.